There we go. Okay, so welcome everybody. This is the first seminar in a series of seminars designed to inform anybody who would like to participate in the review of the Reef 2050 Water Quality Improvement Plan. Today's session is a really big picture session around what is this plan? What are all the bits that fall together to form the plan, and what is the process for reviewing the plan and how you can get involved. My name is Maria Rosier. I work for the Department of Environment and Science and Innovation in Queensland Government. Presenting with me today is Matthew Fullerton, also in the Department of Environment, Science and Innovation. This is a joint initiative under the both Australian and federal government. Next slide, please, Emma. So before I start, I would like to acknowledge the traditional custodians of the lands where we all meet today. I am on Yagara and Turrbal country in Meanjin. I pay my respects to elders past and present. I would like to acknowledge the traditional owners and custodians of the reef. And what we talk when we talk about the reef, we talk about the reef in the ocean, but also the reef in the land, and that really deep connection between land, sea, and people. I pay my respects to all elders, past and present. And if we have any First Nations people in the call today, I pay my respects to you, your story, and your elders, past and present. So before we jump into, you know, the plan with objectives and things, I want us to take a really step back and think about what does water mean for us. The title of the plan is called the Water Quality Improvement Plan, but it has different meanings for different people. So when we think about water, we think about life. Water is life. Water is what sustains life on this planet. And we often refer to that as environmental values. When we talk about water, we talk about employment and prosperity, and we talk about economic values. When we talk about water, we mean culture and spirituality, and we then talk about cultural values. And we also mean enjoyment. We mean time with our families, with our friends, and we talk about social values. So in that context, when we talk about the water improvement plan, we're really talking about how the landscapes and local waterways are maintained healthy, how marine ecosystems are healthy, and how communities are healthy, and how that connection works together. The title of the plan is called the Water Quality Improvement Plan. And when we talk about water quality, we talk about three things. So first of all is sediments and the role that suspended sediments has in waterways and the turbidity that it causes. And what that means is that it reduces light in the water column, which then affects the ability of coral and seagrasses to produce energy through photosynthesis. That then can also smother organisms and have physiological effects. So sediments enter waterways through erosion, eroded landscapes, eroded waterways. People do also work really, really hard to manage erosion. Nobody benefits from eroded landscapes. And I think a big shout out to all the land managers who are working really hard in this space. And we have the next seminar, we're going to be talking about the range of programs that are underway to minimize the impacts of erosion on reef catchments. When we talk about water quality, we also talk about nutrients and the role that nutrients have in water. We particularly focus on dissolved inorganic nitrogen, particulate nitrogen, and particulate phosphorus. The inputs from fertilizers and how those nutrients end up in waterways and the effects that then it has on our reef ecosystems. Algae in particular, they love nutrients. When waterways are heavy in nutrients, we can see algal blooms. When combined with the sediments, they can cause flocs and then impact coral health. Nutrient management is a global issue. It is not, nutrient-rich environments often lose biodiversity. This is an extract from Switzerland, where it shows a very nutrient-rich field with one type of flower, and in a field where the soil is balanced in nutrients, you can see in biodiversity there. And we also talk about pesticides when we're talking about water quality, and pesticides can cause physiological effects on organisms and ecosystems. So in the water quality improvement plan, we bring these pieces into a connected picture. This is an extract from the current water quality improvement plan, and it really represents the interconnectivity between how we manage the land, that inner shore environment, what are the values, the pressures, the threats, and the activities that occur, and how does that come together. The water quality improvement plan really covers what we call reef catchments. It is an enormous area. It's 424,000 square kilometers across six NRM regions, 35 catchments. And I think for anybody who works or has worked in this space, the scale is amazing. We know that. Oh, sorry, Emma. Just go back one, please. Thank you. Monsoonal rain and cyclones are a big component of our weather systems, especially in far north Queensland, and we know that coming from this summer. Agricultural land use is a big part of the land use, and it takes about 90% of the land uses in the catchment. We also know that the urban environments contribute in particular to the dissolved inorganic nitrogen in the reef. So I will pass on to Matthew just to give us the really big picture around how Australia manages the reef.
Thanks, Maria. Yeah, so as Maria said at the start, the Water Quality Improvement Plan fits into a broader framework, which is the Reef 2050 Long-Term Sustainability Plan. And the Reef 2050 Plan is really built on the principle that collective action is required across the three levels of government, a whole broad range of different industries that operate within the World Heritage Area and within the more than 400,000 square kilometres of catchment that drain into the Great Barrier Reef Lagoon, across in partnership with traditional owners, and communities, environment, natural resource management organisations, et cetera, and all the people that live in that catchment. So the Reef 2050 plan has a long-term vision for the reef, that the reef is sustained as a living natural and cultural wonder of the world, reflecting that, you know, we have international obligations around protecting the World Heritage Area on behalf of the international community, and that the reef is a significant biodiversity hotspot with global significance, and that it holds natural ecological values as well as significant cultural values for traditional owners, 65,000 plus years of deep connection with the Great Barrier Reef. So the Reef 2050 plan is about drawing together all the different threads of involvement in protecting and dealing with the various pressures on the reef, with front and center focus on the fact that climate change is the biggest threat to the reef. And, you know, we're really yet again experiencing the direct impacts of the reef of climate change and global warming on the reef this year with another significant mass bleaching event. And at this point, I really want to acknowledge the, you know, deep cultural impact that that has for traditional owners, seeing the damage to their cultural heritage, as well as for all the communities that, that care about the Great Barrier Reef. And the reality is that that ecological trauma is real. So, you know, very sensitive in terms of where things are at in this this story. But the Reef 2050 plan then focuses on dealing both with the need to reduce those global emissions to lower the risk of further warming impacting the reef under the Paris Agreement, as well as supporting the local environments to be able to adapt better to a changed future, both in the catchment as well as with, for example, the Reef Restoration Adaptation Program, looking at new ways to help corals, to see what science can do to help corals adapt to warmer waters. So along with that, you know, the Reef 2050 plan looks at the management of the catchment, but it also looks at management within the marine environment itself. So such things as fishing, and in the last 12 to 18 months, there have been some fairly significant reforms of how fishing is managed in the Great Barrier Reef in response to some of the concerns from the UNESCO World Heritage Committee with the phasing out of gillnet fishing across the Great Barrier Reef, as well as other, you know, significant impacts on particular species from marine debris, which can come both from our catchment, but also come in from the international waters and from shipping, etc. So the Reef 2050 plan looks at all of these range of threats. It also looks at, you know, what happens along the coastline, and in 2012, when the international interest in the situation with the reef was really ramping up, there was a particular focus on the threat of possible future development and a lot of port expansions being proposed at that time. The World Heritage Committee asked Australia to deliver a more comprehensive plan to protect the Great Barrier Reef, which was delivered in 2015, and one of the significant commitments there was the, you know, reducing the possibility of future port impacts through the Sustainable Ports Act. So that's something that has, you know, really resulted from the Reef 2050 plan, and port development is constrained to those four major ports, and not to expanding other ports. And, you know, those kind of activities have only continued. Ports have continued to do their master planning and improving how they manage maintenance dredging, etc., as well as things like all the kind of coastal environments, looking at, you know, how to change things like management of lights from urban areas and port activities to reduce the impacts on marine turtles, etc. So how we work together, so the focus in the catchment is particularly between the Queensland Government and the Commonwealth Department of Climate Change, Energy, Environment and Water at the high level, in terms of how we manage environmental impact assessments through both state and Commonwealth legislation, as well as how both governments fund activities in the catchment in partnership with a whole range of organisations and communities up and down the coast. And then into the water, there's joint management again between the Commonwealth Great Barrier Reef Marine Park Authority and the Queensland Parks and Wildlife Service through the Joint Field Management Program, which has been managing the federal and state marine park and marine parks and island national parks for more than 45 years now. So that there's that real collective and shared effort between the state and federal governments there in the management of various aspects of the reef. And so specifically in the addressing of the land-based impacts, as Maria is talking today about the Water Quality Improvement Plan, that's also complemented by the Reef 2050 Wetland Strategy, which a new version was launched earlier this year. So those are really the two major strategies in dealing with the management of catchment impacts on the Great Barrier Reef. And at this point, I'm going to hand back to Maria to continue.
Thanks, Matthew. Yes, so as Matthew was saying, that how we manage the land is really important to protect the reef, and we have those two documents working side by side, the Wetland Strategy and the Water Quality Improvement Plan. I think this has been a long journey, the planning for the reef, and we are here today in 2024 after an enormous amount of effort and expertise and thinking. So I think it's really important that we acknowledge the adaptive management and the growth in the knowledge that we have around the reef as an ecosystem and the land, and how we manage the land to support the reef. Of particular things to note on that in this journey is that this will be the fifth version of the plan. So certainly building on that cumulative knowledge and journey. Traditional owner implementation plan, which was released in 2022. I'll talk a little bit more about that. And of course, as Matthew was mentioning, the Reef 2050 long-term sustainability plan, which brings all the different bits of the puzzle together. In a nutshell, the water quality improvement plan is the framework that guides actions in reef catchments to improve the water quality that flows to the reef. We do have seminar series number two, the next one, which will be talking about those programs and those projects that have been funded through the current water quality improvement plan framework. In a picture, the current water quality improvement plan has as outcome that good water quality sustains the outstanding universal value of the reef, builds resilience, improves ecosystems' health and the health of communities, and benefits communities. So the vision already encompasses that connection in between catchments, communities, the reef, and the importance that water and water quality plays in that connection. The whole framework, the whole water quality improvement plan, is under review from the objectives, from the vision that it sets through to the objectives. It has water quality targets that were set to 2025. It has targets for how we manage land, including targets for the agricultural sector, for the urban sector, as well as for catchment condition. It has human dimension targets, acknowledging the important role that humans play in managing catchments and improving water quality. And then towards the back of the document, it has a series of action tables with actions that together will contribute towards those target objectives and targets. So that whole framework is under review, starting from the top, from the objectives. These are the current objectives that the current water quality improvement plan set. So that improving coral condition and seagrass condition talks about that reef, the water quality connection to those two reef indicators. It has catchment objectives around improving wetland conditions and improving biodiversity. It also has human-based objectives around how we manage catchments, but also the role that we play in driving change, improving governance, and maintaining viable communities. Next down in that story is the water quality target. So they were set to 2025. They're currently under review and we're looking at setting targets to 2030. Seminar 5 will cover this review and what the water quality targets are in much more detail than I can provide. But in a nutshell, the water quality targets are ecologically relevant targets, which means they're really what they're based on what the ecosystems needs to thrive, in particular the coral and the seagrasses. And they're really set around what are the anthropogenic or the human-based reductions that we could achieve. So for fine sediment, the target is a reduction in 25% of the anthropogenic or human sediment load to the reef. Dissolved inorganic nitrogen is 60% reduction. Particulate nutrients is 20% reduction. And for pesticides, we're looking at over 99% of aquatic species protected. The Reef report card was recently published, the 21-22 report card, and there shows the progress that we're making towards those targets. Over halfway for the fine sediment target, almost at the halfway point for the dissolved inorganic nitrogen target. We report targets at a whole of Great Barrier Reef scale. I think that scale conversation is really important because the area is huge. So we break the water quality targets into three tiers, from the Great Barrier Reef scale to regional targets to then basin specific targets. And I think that's where we start to get information that is more useful for us to be making management decisions. The table there, the colorful table on the side, they're called, we call the review of that table the Spatial Management Prioritization Project. So we're looking at reviewing that table to make sure that those water quality targets at a basin level reflect the latest science. So we're also reviewing the land management practice adoption targets for agriculture. Seminar 4 will go deeper into that review process. The current WQIP, the current Water Quality Improvement Plan, sets 2025 targets that 90% of land in priority areas is managed using best practice systems for water quality outcomes. There has been an enormous effort by the agricultural sector to progress towards that target, and we're currently working with a number of working groups around making sure that that big picture target that is probably doesn't tell a lot can tell a more regional and commodity specific picture. We're also revisiting the catchment management targets, and these are around, they're really around catchment condition. So we're really reporting, monitoring and reporting against the extent of riparian vegetation, the extent of wetlands, and condition of grazing land in terms of land cover. That's also under review, and Seminar 4 will talk about the review of those targets as in one picture. And we're also reviewing the urban water management target. So currently the urban water management target is super high level. It states that the management of urban, industrial, and public lands for water quality shows an improving trend. There's been a lot of work done looking at what does that mean for urban environments and what roles does the urban sector and the urban communities have playing in this role. So again, seminar 3 will go into further detail on the review of the urban water management target. And we're also looking at, we call them human dimension targets. This really tells the story around what motivates the humans to play a role in and participate in water quality projects. So there's a range of aspirations that really motivates people to play a role in this space. And I think, as Matthew said, it takes teamwork to make the magic happen. The human dimension targets really try to articulate what that teamwork looks like. And underpinning the Water Quality Improvement Plan is the Paddock to Reef Monitoring and Reporting Program. So this is a first-class reporting program that monitors and models the water quality journey from paddock to the reef. We have two seminars that will go into how we'll report and monitor six and seven. But through the program, we get the reef report cards that give us that snapshot on how we're progressing towards targets. So that captures what is currently in the water quality improvement plan and all the bits of the puzzle that are currently under review. And hopefully you get a sense that the other seminars, you'll be able to dive a bit deeper into each of those bits of the puzzle. I'll talk a little bit now about what the process looks like for review, and in particular, how you can get involved. So in terms of objectives of the review, we spoke about that timeline and the journey that we've been through to get to version number 4 of this water quality improvement plan. This is a continuous adaptive management process. So we're absolutely looking to building on the knowledge, experience, and successes of the past. And in particular, traditional owner knowledge and science. I think there's been a huge improvement on how we report and acknowledge traditional owner knowledge and science. And there is, the time is now for us to really reflect that in the next version of the plan. We're looking to build a more holistic and inclusive narrative and story that really builds on the aspirations of reef communities, that is certainly building from the story that the Water Quality Improvement Plan already has, that interconnectivity between the reef catchments, the reef communities, and the reef. We'll be taking a good look at the priority actions. So currently the Water Quality Improvement Plan has many actions, and we're going to be looking at whether those actions are fit for purpose in 2025. We're also looking at whether there are new actions or activities that we'd like to see out there. And we'd like to be able to provide a clearer and simpler maybe framework so that those working under this story understand and connects to what we're trying to achieve. So I mentioned that we're trying to bring a lot of information together. I did speak about the reviews underway around the water quality targets and the spatial management prioritization, the land management practice adoption for agriculture, the catchment management target, human dimension targets, and the urban targets. We're also in the process of finalizing the scientific consensus statement. We're working hard on how we can embed the traditional owner knowledge and science into the next version of the plan, as well as community and stakeholder engagement. A big part of this journey is having an inclusive engagement process so that people can be part of the conversation, part of the policy process. The scientific consensus statement is an independent scientific report, which brings together over 76 authors and contributors. This will be released in the next few months, and it really gives us that scientific Western scientific knowledge around the water quality and the management actions to support a healthy reef. The traditional owner implementation plan was released in 2022 and sets an amazing foundation for how we embed traditional owner knowledge and science in the next version of the plan. Traditional owners have documented how they see the connectivity between the land, the water, and the reef, and how they would like them to that connectivity to be protected and managed. So a big part of this review is making sure that the next version of the plan allows traditional owners to carry out their rights in caring for country. We have a range of advisory groups in a pretty set governance framework that guides this review. That traditional owner implementation plan a traditional owner task force is being established and to advise government on how to manage the reef in accordance with the traditional owner implementation plan. This is a joint government process. So we have both the Australian and the Queensland government Great Barrier Reef ministers making joint decisions on how we manage the reef. We have a reef advisory committee, which has a range of stakeholders, and a reef independent expert panel, which has a range of reef independent experts advising those ministers. We also have a reef water quality independent science panel. And in government, then we have an executive steering committee that manages those conversations and manages the government business. In addition to that, we also have a range of groups that we engage with very often, which we will be using as part of this process. So I mentioned before that engagement is a really key component of this plan. We talked about the scale of reef catchments and how big the area is, but equally how big the human numbers is. There's over 2.4 million humans living in those reef catchments, and there's millions more humans who really care for the reef and don't live in the reef catchments. So we've designed an engagement process where we listen first before starting to bring those pieces together, before having a draft public consultation version of the plan before it gets finalized. So the objective is really that we create a new narrative, a new set of objectives. We articulate what the implementation principles are, and we set priority actions for the future. The next plan will go to 2030. We are at the very beginning of this journey, and thank you so much for joining us on the journey. We are in that listening stage. We have a few things happening at the moment in listening. We've provided a series of seminars to help people understand the different layers and the work that is currently underway, and with the hope that it will inform everybody so that when they come in to have conversations with us, we can really have the good conversations. We also have a survey available at the moment, which allows anybody to provide the success stories that they're celebrating and what are they celebrating about them. And we're going to collect that information and build it into bring it together with the other bits of the puzzle into creating the new narrative, the next set of objectives, implementation principles, and priority actions. Early next year, we'll be doing a public consultation round. Our hope is that bringing you in early in the journey means that by the time we're running that public consultation process, we can really get deep into the implementation, into, well, what are the actions that will really drive the outcomes that we're looking for before finalizing the plan, and then the communications and the implementation of the plan that comes thereafter. So this is the moment where I'm going to ask Emma to please stop recording, and where we're really keen to hear your thoughts.